Okay, so we're on. Good morning. Come on, everybody. Stand to your feet. Let's praise Him. He's worthy of worship. Amen. Come on. Let's give Him a shout.
Jump, 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 everybody. or last week, and vacation not long before that, so it just feels like I've been gone from home, which is right here, for a while. So it's really good to see everybody this morning. It's good to see a couple of you that have been out, because we've been like hit and miss, not seeing each other. That's kind of how the summer ends up with people traveling. But it's really good to be right here in the house of the Lord this morning. How many of you agree? Well, it's good to see you, and I'm glad you all could be here this morning. I'd like to also welcome those watching on the World Wide Web. Let's turn around and give them a shout out this morning. It's good to have you with us this morning. Well, I hope you all are blessed this morning. And you know, I was reading this morning about opening up the windows of heaven, like that this first song is talking about. Just the Lord pouring over us. We're stirring up deep wells. We're stirring up things deep within to start bubbling out and pouring over. We can't reach people on the outside until we start bubbling over, until we get so full of what the Lord has for us personally. Then the excess, that which starts coming up and it starts oozing out of us onto everybody around us. The Lord wants so much to just bless his people like that. Not just enough, but the Bible says over and over again how he wants to give us more than enough.
That's right.
More than what we could ever dream or imagine or think. More than what we can even comprehend. He wants to give us that much. So my prayer this morning is that you would just open up yourself and allow yourself to enter in this morning. Just worship him freely this morning. Just allow him to come and pour over everything that you need in your life. Just open yourself up. And you know, when we worship him freely, you know, it's not just about opening our mouth and singing the songs that are, you know, on the screen, or maybe not even just raising our hands. It's about from deep within, down deep in our heart and our spirit, that we cry out to him and say, Lord, I need you more than I need anything.
Yes.
I need you more than I need the answers to my questions. I need you more than I need the answers to my prayers. I just need you and your presence and your spirit in my life. That's what I need more than anything. And I'll never be satisfied all the time until I can learn to get him deep down inside me. So I would just welcome you to just come and enter in this morning into this time of praise and worship this morning. I'm going to go ahead and pray over the service. Lord, we thank you so much for this opportunity to meet together in our Jesus and to worship your holy name this morning. Lord, everything we do here in this place is before you. It's all unto you. It's all because of you and what you've done for us and who you are, Lord Jesus. Lord, we ask that you would just come and be here amongst us in this place. Lord, if you're not here, we might as well just give up and leave. Lord, everything we do is because of you. It's because we need you so much in our lives, Lord Jesus. We're nothing without you. Lord, come this morning. Bless your people, Lord Jesus. Lord, we know you're so faithful, Lord Jesus, even when we're not. Lord, come and bless your people this morning, Lord. Open our hearts, open our minds to receive the word this morning. Lord, that the seeds would be planted deep inside, Lord Jesus. And Lord, that we would nurture it and it would grow, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, come and have your way in the service this morning. Lord, bless those that were unable to come this morning. Bless those watching on the web this morning, Lord Jesus. Lord, it doesn't matter where we are, you're always there. Lord, we thank you in advance for what you're going to do this morning here at this service, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Amen. Why don't you just turn and greet one another, say hello to somebody, maybe.
Hi.
Morning.
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 Thank you.
sing that out.
No longer bound to sin, I am free.
Come on, are you free? Are you free?
You're the
oh. Thank you.
Father God, we just worship you this morning. We praise your name, Jesus. We give you glory and honor. For God, there is no one like you in this world. There is no one that can heal us like you can. There's no doctor that can put us back together like you can. God, we are in awe of you. We are in sheer awe of your magnitude, of your greatness, of your glory, Father. Father God, I ask that this weekend, Refuge Conference, God, that God, it would be like never before. That God, as we prepare, as we make our plans, God, that you would show up like never before, Father God. That your presence would be there like never before. That God, as the speakers, as Scotty Brulee and Pastor Orlando, they come up and they prepare right now, Father God, that you would put a new word in their spirit. That you would put a new word in their heart for such a time as this. That God, that as we worship you this weekend, that God, you would be honored by it, Father. But God, that wouldn't just be about us. That Father, that this weekend would not just be about us, God, and what we can get from it, and how we can worship and how we can do this. But God, that it would be about this city. That God, that it would be about the people that are in this city that don't know you. That are lost and they're trying to find their way, Father God. And you are the only light that can heal them, God, that can bring revelation to them, that can bring life to them, that can bring just peace to their life, God. So, Father, we just worship you. And we ask that this weekend would be just a dynamic weekend. That the people would just come. We thank you so much, Father God. We worship you.
Right now, Father God, for all the jobs, God, that you've provided for all of us, Father God. Lord, I pray right now, God, that you would just put a financial increase in all of our lives, God, all of the ministries, God, Lord, from the nursery, God, clear up to the pastoral ministry, Father God, all the ministries in between, God, Lord, everybody that affects, Father God, Lord, I just pray right now that you would just increase, God, our finances, Father God.
God, I thank you for the people that you're bringing into this church, God, to serve you and glorify you, God. I pray for Taylor Hayden and their safe travels home, God. I pray that you would just drive their travels and that you would keep them safe, God.
God, I pray for Pastor Mario at our sister church on Brown Road, God. He's such an awesome blessing, God. And we know that he's doing your work, God, in this place. I just pray, God, that you bless him where he is right now, and that you give him all that he needs to continue his work, God.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we pray over BJ Toe, the administrator of all the branches of the Salem Public Library. God, is this gentleman is over all these libraries, God, that touch kids and adults alike, God. We pray that you just bless his life. God, we don't know what he's going through. We don't know if he knows you, God. If he doesn't know you, God, show yourself to him in a real way that he may make you his Lord. God, and if he does know you, God, bless him where he's at. And God, we just pray that you bless the Salem Public Library, all the branches, God, that they would just, as they reach out to this community, God, that you would go with them and before them, God, because libraries are so important, God, and we pray that you bless BJ now and of all the branches of the library.
Ways done for you this morning. remember that your offerings are blessings to this work, to continue the work of this church, and to bless our pastors so that you can focus on the ministry and not have to focus so much on the work. And that's what we want, right? To minister who can focus on growing and building our church. So if you have tithes this morning, make sure they're put in an envelope and marked. If you're giving to the building fund, make sure it's marked and up on an envelope, and we appreciate that. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for all the blessings that you have poured out on each and every one of us, the favor that you have bestowed upon us in our lives. And Lord, we ask you, God, help us to give unconditionally with no strings attached. Give to you, knowing, Lord, that that offering is going to further the gospel and it's going to also bring us your blessings, Lord. I pray today, Lord, that you would bless this offering, that you would multiply it, that it can be used to bring you glory through this church and through the community. In your name we pray. Amen.
I want to thank you for your worship this morning. As Cherry said, we want to continue in our worship. This is the highest form of worship. And we want to just bless the Lord with this last song. Just open up your hearts. Just begin to worship. Like just open worship. Amen.
Oh,
one more time. Should we do it?
I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you.
Come on, sing it with your heart.
I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever.
Sometimes I like to ask God, Why do we have to have bills? Why do we have to have a responsibility? Can't we just, like, stay here, right here in your presence, worshiping you? But instead, I gotta go home, and I gotta go to work, and I gotta do this, and I gotta take care of responsibility. And he says, you know what, son? You make worshiping me your number one responsibility, and the rest will fall into place just fine. You make me number one in your life, and the rest falls into place just fine. I said, God, that's straight up. That's right. So we worship him in spirit and in truth no matter where we are, no matter what time of day. It's just our lifestyle. It's just who we are. We worship him in our car. We worship him in our job. We might be on the streets, in the bus stops. We might be in the grocery store. But wherever we are, we worship him. Amen? If you believe that this morning, just look at your neighbor and say, I'm worshiping today. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, I'm worshiping today. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. After you've told a couple people that, you can be seated in Jesus' name if you can.
If I could have all the young teens that came up, that went up for campus last week, if I could have all of you just come on up to the stage, that would be the E3 leaders to you. All the young people, all of my staff at home. We'll hide behind each other. There's plenty room of stage. There's plenty room of stage. Last week we went to summer camp and it was amazing. We had a Bishop Trevor Reed as our speaker, and came all the way from the East Coast just to open the word and to pour out into our youth. And so I just want to give, if there's any of us, any of these young people, just like say maybe like four or five, that want to just open their mouth and just to testify about what God did for you guys at camp. So is there anyone that wants to? There we go.
Well, at camp, I just feel like the Lord really cleansed me and he empowered me to walk, to come over here, live right, and live boldly. I just feel like I can walk in victory. I can live my life.
All right, who's next? Who's next? I'll pick you. Who's next? How are you, Kathy?
Well, camp was really nice, again. I feel like we just all really grew. It really grew in the Lord, and it was just really nice to be in his presence for a whole week, and the few weeks before that during at the piano, just we've been in God's presence for so long and we don't want to stop.
Amen.
Where the lyrics were supposed to go,
very vague words. Like I was just staring at the board, and in very vague letters, it said, "Do not fear, for I am with you forever and always." And that just really blew my mind, and because I was just praying and praying that I'd stay on the right path after winter camp, being summer camp, and that like I would get to share my my words with people at school. And so then I was praying, and finally he told me, "Kelani, you are changed, and I will be with you forever and always." So then like he told me a scripture, and it's John 15:4. And I'm not going to say the whole scripture, but the first part is, "Remain in me and I will remain in you." So yeah.
Amen. There we go.
Okay, so at camp, I was having a really hard time. Just like, I was getting frustrated with people. I was getting a little short, you know, everyone does that. But I found the core of the issue, and it was the fact that my parents, some stuff that was going on, and my dad's no longer living with us. And I was really bitter towards him, and like, just like, I hated him so much that it was hard for me to like look at other people and just give them grace. And it would just like trigger things that are so dumb, and I'm just like, so I got prayed for by Sandy. And yesterday, we went to a Harp and Bowl meeting at Nathan Webber's church, and my dad was there, and I was able to just give him a hug and give him grace. And before, I wouldn't be able to do that, and I would just freak out, but it was really nice to, like, just be so, just not be mad at him, and I just, like, give him a hug and just extend grace, because if you can't do anything else, grace is the biggest thing you can do to someone.
Amen. I got one more. Here we go.
The food was really good too. But I think my favorite part was probably chapter 8. He has such a powerful word throughout the camp, and it really inspired me. And now I feel like I just can't wait to get back out in school and spread the word and just go out everywhere and start talking and spreading the word of God.
Amen. You know, it's amazing to me. I don't know if you guys recognize this as the adults in the house, but there's something going on in our youth.
Yes, yeah. Amen.
And I take no credit for it. It's him.
Yes, amen.
Our young people right now are on fire. They are on fire to know who they are, to get to know God in a way that they've never had, and to get filled up by him. And they are leading the way right now.
Yes, amen.
I am proud of them. Because when I see them, I see just these just lightning balls of for God. And they're wanting to go out on the streets. They're wanting to go back to school. You know what was cool? Last night, KK and I were talking. And she goes, "I'm excited to go back to school." And she doesn't get to go to the school that she wanted to go to. And she goes, "I'm excited." And I'm like, "Oh, really? Well, what do you mean?" And she goes, "Well, because all the distractions are gone. All of my friends, they're not going to be there. So I'm going to be able to witness to people. I'm going to be able to do the things that I might not have been able to do if my friends would have been there to distract me." Really? That's why you're wanting to go back to school, is to open your mouth and share the love of God? To share the love of God to people? That's why you want to go to school? That's amazing, guys. It's amazing, and I'm just so blessed and honored. Michelle, could you just pray over them and bless them?
God, I just thank you so much. Father, this summer has been a summer full of impact, Father God. God, we've had amazing young leaders step out in faith in this youth ministry, Lord. They've taken steps that they've never taken before to serve you and to honor you. Father, we've had young people who have committed to 8 hours a day just prayer and learning and diving into the word like never before. We've had young people who've gone up to camp and have set the standard for for what worship is and have set the standard for loving others. Father, I thank you for the heart of this youth ministry. I thank you for the heart of these young people, God. God, and as we talked about in Nano, epic change begins with nano-sized decisions. Father, they have made decisions in their life that may seem small, but it will ripple through this city, Father God. And I thank you for that. I thank you for the impact that they are making on their friends and on this surrounding area, Lord. God, I pray you bless them. Continue to stir the fire in their hearts. Let it not be about an experience, but about an authentic relationship
yes.
with you.
Yes.
God, thank you for them. Bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, and just continue to fill them up to overflowing. In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.
Let's give these kids a hand, can we? They're a good teenager. Hallelujah. Well, I'll tell you what, I feel like I've already had church today. How about yourself?
Amen.
I feel like I've already had church today.
Amen.
And, you know, anytime you can feel like you've already had church before the message even comes, then you're in a good service already, you know. And some of y'all are like, yes, I feel that way too, Pastor. You can just go on now. You know, we don't even have to have the Word. But you know what? The Word is rich. The Word is true. The Word is our life. It's our manna. It's our bread. It's our meat. It's what we need. And without it, guess what? We're powerless. You've got to have the Word, because in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Without that, what are we? Where are we? Who are we? We need the Word. So we're going to get into the Word today. I don't know if we're on here yet, Matthew.
It's on.
I appreciate Matthew. You might see Matthew running around all over the church. That's because Cameron is out of town with Stacy because it's his birthday. And so they're celebrating their birthday on the coast. And we also have another birthday, our head usher. It's his birthday today as well. Happy birthday, Lance. God bless you. Are we good now? Okay, I'll put this away. And yeah, so it's good to see some of your smiling faces, some of our visitors, good to see you. I met some people this week that I was so excited about. I had one guy come in, do a whole Broadway solo for me right here in the theater. Said he's gonna come, and here he is today. God bless you, sir. Good to see ya. Another new friend, Aaron. Aaron and his fiance, is it Mianke? Mianse? It's me, Mason. Mason. Okay. And I don't usually. Okay. Not good. He's not good with names. I am terrible with names. Yeah. So they are a lovely couple that is getting married. I don't normally embarrass people like this, but I know that they're probably not embarrassed because our spirits clicked right from the get-go a couple days ago. And so it's good to have him. He's a worship leader at his church in Reading. And they are just a fantastic couple. And now you got to hear the story that they found a card of ours that doesn't exist in the grass, in the dark, while he's looking for his wallet that he lost in a park. Now, where that card came from, we tried to identify the card. We still have not yet completely 100% identified that card. But somehow that card led him here a couple days ago. And it's good to have you guys with us. So God bless you. I want you to know that next week is our conference, our fourth annual conference, and you know me, if any of you know me at all, this is one of my favorite times of the year. I love conference, because some of my pastor friends come from all over the country to kind of get involved. They sow into our church, they invest in us as a body, and you know, sometimes that's needed, right? I mean, we need that investment from other people into us. And how many of you know Pastor Orlando? He helped us birth the church. He's been in every conference of ours since we birthed the church. And he is going to be here lighting it up opening night. You do not want to miss that. It's Friday night. If you know Orlando, he never lets up, right? He doesn't ever come in halfway. He always comes 100% ready to light you up, and you do not want to miss Friday night. Starts at 7. But I'm going to tell you, you need to get here early so you can get a decent seat. Otherwise, you may be in trouble. So make sure that you get here early. Starts at 7. The doors will be open plenty early for you to get a good seat, okay? Saturday morning, it is open to everybody. Look at your programs. We've got a a round table where we have several senior pastors coming in. They're going to sit on this stage. They're going to give you 5 to 10 minutes of power. And when these guys bring it, they bring it. I've been told almost every year that this is their favorite part of the conference. And they're just going to bring you some powerful stuff. If you're a leader or an aspiring leader or you just want to grow some more, you need to be here Saturday morning, okay? Right after that, we will have another session, general session, I believe at 11. And I will be bringing the word at that afternoon, Saturday session. Then Scotty Brulee will bring the word Saturday night in our general session Saturday night. He is a powerful man of God. He was the associate pastor of a 10,000 member church. He was also the youth pastor of Casey Treats Church up in Seattle. He's been around. He's been in business for a long time, and he knows the Word of God. He's going to light us up as well on Saturday night and Sunday morning. So make sure you get here. I'm telling you, you do not want to miss conference. If at all possible, you want to be here, okay? I'm super charged up. I'm super excited. We've got some dancers, some young ladies that are going to be bringing some life to this stage with dance. They were at our convention. They're at senior camp right now in Idaho, and they're flying straight from there to our conference on Friday so that they can dance for us a couple times this weekend. So that's going to be a lot of fun. We also have a worship band from Modesto, California, that called me on the phone out of the blue asking about our church. Said, Pastor, I don't know why. We just feel like we need to meet you. I said, well, where'd you get my name? How did you get our church? They said, well, we have family in the area, so we Googled churches in Salem. Yours came up. We went to your website, and we knew we had to meet you. We don't need a gig. We don't need to play. We just want to serve. Is there anything we can do? Do you need walls painted? Do you need this done? They just want to serve, and they will be here on Saturday for the entire day, and I'm excited to see what God does in their young lives. They're an up-and-coming band touring all over the country. And you'll get to meet them on Saturday. Okay, enough of that. There's a light there so I can see it. I want to make sure we're not printing these for nothing. All right, good. Take those home. Make sure you read them, okay? Make sure you read them. Austin's good to see you guys. That little guy is especially good to see that little guy. You know, the two older ones, But that little guy, wow. You know, sometimes, you know, we get so busy in the summer that we miss each other. You know, you're in church, I'm not. I'm in church, you're not. And we're going to the beach, and we're going to camping, and we're on vacations, and we got to work, and we don't get to see everybody. I'm so going to be so blessed on, you know, come fall when all the kids are back in school, everybody's back at work, and you're all back in church. You know what I'm saying? I just can't wait. I just get everybody together. So, and football season's starting. So, come on, Hawks. Come on, somebody. Help me out. All right. Yeah, I want to start with a story about a man.
Cleveland Brown.
And this man, he was a great worker. He painted lines in the road. And the county hired this new guy to paint fresh yellow lines down the middle of all the county roads. The first day, this man painted an astonishing 10 miles of road with new double yellow lines down the middle of all the county roads, 10 miles by himself in a single day. This was a record, and no one had ever painted 10 miles of the yellow lines in one day, and the boss was very impressed. Although still good, the second day, the man only painted 7 miles of yellow lines. And then the third day, the man managed to only paint 5 miles of yellow lines, in which really isn't that good. The boss thought the man had a bad day, but when on the fourth day the man only managed to paint 1 mile of yellow lines, the boss knew he had no choice. He had to call him in the office and find out what's going on. So the man began to tell him that the painting of the lines was getting more and more difficult every single day. And he said, well, what's going on? Why is that? And the man looked at the boss and said, well, every single time I get further out, it takes longer to get back to the paint bucket. And I guess he was going 10 miles to paint 10 miles back anyway. You're going to understand why that story is significant. Sometimes we're getting too far from our source. Let me tell you something. Sometimes we get too far from our source. That paint bucket was his source to do his job. And every time he would he would work his heart out. But every once in a while, he'd get too far from the source. And then he was ineffective. We got to make sure that we remain at the source. Amen? We got to stay at the source. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 10. starting in verse 17. I'm going to read a little bit quickly because we don't have much time left. If you're not there, you can catch up. If you're there, say amen. Mark chapter 10, verse 17 through 27. I know Matthew's doing a fantastic job for camera today, so it'll be on the screen for you. Verse 17 says, as Jesus was starting out on his way to Jerusalem, a man came running up to him, knelt down, and asked, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus asked. Only God is truly good. But you must not testify falsely. But to answer your question, you know the commandments. You must not murder. You must not commit adultery. You must not steal. You must not testify falsely. You must not cheat anyone. Honor your father and mother. Verse 20. Teacher, the man replied, I've obeyed all these commandments since I was young. Looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. There is still one thing you haven't done, he told him. Go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. At this, the man's face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. This amazed them, but Jesus said again, dear children, it is very hard to enter the kingdom of God. In fact, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were astounded. Then who in the world can be saved? They asked. Jesus looked at them intently and said, humanly speaking, it is impossible, but not with God. With God, everything is possible. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word and what it does to our life. I thank you that it is rich, and I thank you that it is alive. God, I pray that you would open our ears, open our hearts to receive your word, that it would change us forever. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to tell you a little story about my niece. She's the cutest thing, and while we were on vacation, we were blessed to have my brother-in-law, my sister, and her family join us on vacation in California for a few days. And while we were there, we went to a friend of ours, Pastor Daryl, in L.A. He pastors a great church in L.A., and we were hanging out with him at his pool. So we were in the pool, and my little niece, Malia, she's only, what, 4 years old? Is that right?
Yeah.
Anybody know 4 years old? She's four. So she's 4 years old and can't swim yet. And she's a little bit afraid of the water, and we're trying to get her to just kind of dive in, you know. And I didn't want to teach her like my dad taught me when he just threw me in the pool to swim, son, you know. Come on, if you want to live, you're going to swim, you know. That's how they teach you nowadays. And I didn't want to do that. Neither did her dad, and nobody else wanted to see that. So we just kind of gently, like, come on, Malia, come on, jump in. Let's switch. You know, she got this terrified, you know, and so sometimes I would ask her, like, Malia, do you think you're going to drown? No. I go, well, come on, huh? Do you think Uncle would let you drown? No. Well, come on, then, huh? You know, do you think I'm going to put you under the water? No. Well, then come, huh? You know, and she knew that I wasn't going to kill her. She knew that I wouldn't let her drown, but she couldn't get herself to move. Sometimes we feel like that in our Christian life. We know God is there. We know he exists. We know he's more powerful than anything. We know he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We know he's our healer, our provider. But sometimes we can't get ourselves to move. We can't activate our faith. We say we have faith, but it's hard to activate it. We know we want to believe. We believe it all, but we can't get going. You know what's interesting is that finally, after a few hours, we kind of left her alone in the shallow part with Kennedy, and Kennedy would help her out a little bit, you know, they're pretty close cousins, and all of a sudden, a few hours later, she goes, Uncle, Uncle! I'm like, what? She goes, look, I'm doing it! I'm like, what are you doing? I'm swimming underwater! I go, really? Show me! She goes like this. I go, good job! You know, good job! Swimming underwater. She would just put her face in, that's it. You know? And eventually she was confident enough, she knew that she wasn't gonna die, that she would at least put her face in. When will the day come when some Christians will at least put their face in the water?
All right, come on.
There are some Christians that won't put their foot in the water, let alone their face. Could you imagine being on the boat during the waves and Jesus calls out to you and said, Carlos, calm. Carlos says, is he talking to me? Carlos, calm. Carlos would look at Jesus and say, Jesus, if that's you, call me out there. Well, then I did come. And some of us as Christians, we wouldn't even be doing this kind of thing, you know. But let me just check this out first, God. You know, this is water, you know. And then we don't even get out of the boat. And I just picture Jesus, our Abba Father, being in the pool going, come on, jump, jump. And we're on the edge of the pool going, oh, oh. And God is looking at us saying, you know I'm not going to let you drown. No, I know. Well, then come on, jump. You're like, huh. God's looking at us saying, you know I won't let you sink. I know that, God. I know that. Well, then come on, jump. Huh. And that's how we live our Christian life sometimes. That's how we live our faith. That's how we live our walk. We want to pray for everything, but we don't want to step in. See, we all have a little level of faith. Some of us have more than others. We've all been given a measure of faith, but we haven't all activated it. See, I believe that with God, nothing is impossible. As the scripture says, nothing is impossible for God. He says, with human man, with mankind, I know it's impossible. But with me, your God, nothing is impossible. It's about time that we as Christians live a life that reflects what we believe.
Yes, that's right.
We talk about it, but we don't reflect it. We preach it, but we don't reflect it. We teach it, but we don't reflect it. It's about time that we as believers live a life that reflects what we believe. We say we're blessed, but we live depressed. Hello? I might go to some of y'all. How you doing? Oh, I'm blessed, Pastor.
But I gotta tell you.
Tell me what? Just stop right there. I don't want to hear it. I just want to know you're blessed. That's it. Now start living like you're blessed.
Yes.
Not like you're depressed. We say God's alive, but we live like he's dead. We say we're a child of God, but we live like we're still Annie Orphan. I know, y'all are getting that picture in your head. I know, y'all are looking at me funny. Thank you, Nicole. Appreciate that. Love ya. Listen, I know your situation may seem impossible right now, but with God, all things are possible. It seems like things are never going to get better, but with God, all things are possible. It seems like you're just going to be sick forever, but guess what? With God, all things are possible. You may seem like you're never going to get that promotion, but I'm telling you, with God, all things are possible. You may feel like your house is going to be broken up into pieces for the rest of your life, but let me tell you something, with God, all things are possible. Do you believe it?
Amen.
All things are possible. Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, and this man comes running up to him and asked him, good teacher, what must I do to have eternal life? What must I do, God? Jesus, to have eternal life. And let me pause for just a moment. When your life reflects the glory of God, when your life reflects the goodness of who he is, people will run to you. People are going to seek you out. They're going to find you. When people see the reflection of God in you, they're going to run to you. Whether you like it or not, whether you asked for it or not, whether you knew it was coming or not, they're coming after you. Just as my story went last week, when I had a dinner meeting in a bar with a client, we had no idea the impact we would have on complete strangers bellied up to the bar. Had no idea. And yet I believe that man's life was changed that night. Because after we ate our dinner, he comes and grabs my shoulder. Now that's some boldness right there. Now he might have had a few drinks. You're a little bolder when you have a few drinks, I know. You know, maybe that's the way we get everybody saved. I don't know. Hey, come on. Come on. No, have another. Come on. Now. You need Jesus?
Yes, I do.
I don't know. Okay, maybe that's a few years off, Bishop. I know, but we're not going that direction. We're not going that direction. But I'm just saying, this man was bold, and he grabs my shoulder on his way out of that bar. I go, hey, man, what's going on? He goes, I just want to thank you. With as serious of a look on his face as he could have, like he had no drinks in him whatsoever, he looks at me and says, I just want to thank you. I needed what you were saying today. You have no earthly idea how you impact people. And when you reflect who God is, they will come to you. In the highways and in the byways, at the church or at your work, they are going to come to you because they need what you have. How many people are asking you how they can get into heaven? How many people are asking you how they can have what you have? Jesus then asked, why do you call me good? Only God is good, but I'll answer your question. And he answers, he goes on to answer his question, and he starts, just laying it out. You know, thou shalt not murder. You know, thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not cheat. Thou shalt honor your father and your mother. Thou shalt, thou shalt, thou shalt. Now, of course, this is what this young man expected to hear. He expected to hear this. Oh, yes, Jesus, and I've been doing this since I was a young lad. I've been keeping the commandments since I was young. And I believe that Jesus probably had a little chuckle in his voice right at the time. He was like, yeah, I know you have. I'm not asking you if you've kept the commandments. I'm telling you you've kept your commandments. I'm telling you, you've kept the commandments, but yet there's still one thing missing. He says to the young man, there's still one thing missing, and this is what you forgot. And Jesus explained to him, go, sell all your possessions, and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. Now listen, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that you won't make it into heaven if you have lots of treasure or if you have a fat bank account or if you're driving my Bentley. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying that you're not going to heaven. All I'm saying is that Jesus was trying to make a point to him that it's not always about the commandments. It's not always about the law. It's not always about the rules. You forgot something very simple. What's very simple is that you're not willing to give up what you want for what I want. Yeah. You're not willing to give up where you want to be to follow me. See, we want... Listen. We want the blessings of God. We want Him to work on our behalf, but we want Him to work on our behalf if it's convenient for us. If it works out in our schedule, then God work on my behalf. We want God to heal us. All the meanwhile, we're holding on to things that make us sick. We want God to deliver us while we hold on to the very things that are binding us. We want God to save us while at the very same time we're holding on to the very things that are killing us. And he says, listen, you kept the commandments, but you're not willing to let go of things. You're not willing to lay your own desires aside so that you will understand what it is I want for your life. Our text says that the man fell at his face. And he went away sad because he had many possessions. What's interesting is that this is a young man who was successful already. He had many possessions already. That means he was rich. That's basically what the Bible's telling us. This cat had cash. He might have rolled up in a nice donkey and cart or whatever they drove around in those days. You know, I don't know. He might have had some slick you know, Burks. That's what they wore back then, right? I mean, not everybody, but he might have had them. And although he had all of this stuff, he came running to God. Or he came running to Jesus. So there was something in his mind already that knew that all this stuff wasn't enough. It wasn't enough to get him anywhere. Because I'm sure that he rolled up pretty nice, pretty clean cut, full of riches. He had everything. He might have even had some really cool three-quarter pants on. You know, because that's in style now. And he knew that that wasn't enough. When are we going to learn that what we have and what we do and what we know is not enough? It's not enough. We want to activate our faith, but we don't want to release the very things that are keeping us bound. It's not always possessions either that limit our faith from working. Because I know some of y'all, you're like, hey, I'll give up my car right now. I don't like it anyway. I hate this house. God, I'll give it up gladly. My kids, take them. That's fine. There's a lot of stuff I'll give up right now, God, if you'll just bless me. It's not always about your stuff. We want God to activate our faith, but we're not willing to give up of our time. We think that God's going to activate our faith, and we're just Sunday-only goers. Hello? Some of you are like, oh, don't go there, Pastor. Just don't go there. Please, don't go there. Listen, we're a church that believes in family. We want you to go on vacation. We want you to go to the coast. We want you to go to the beach. We want you to have your barbecues. We want all of that. But when it comes down to the bottom line, God is saying to you, will you give up what you want for what I want?
Yes.
Will you? See, we want to see God activate our faith, but we won't give up our pride. There's things we haven't given up yet in order to activate our faith. And remember, each and every one of us has a measure of faith. We just have not yet learned how to activate it. I was really close to showing you a Wonder Twins power activate. Does anybody remember that?
Yeah.
I was close. Because see, the Wonder Twins had power, but it had to be activated. Right? They had power, but unless they activated it, it meant nothing. And we as believers have so much power in the Word of God, but we need to learn to activate our faith. Sometimes our faith isn't activated because we're holding on to our pride. We won't give up our preferences. And listen, I'm thoroughly convinced that some of us have not activated our faith because we have not let go of our own preferences. We have selfish preferences. Do you know I can name people, and I won't. I can name people that will not sit in this place and worship with us because they don't dig the theater thing. They have a preference. So they can't worship with us because they don't dig the theater thing. I've had people tell me that they have a hard time entering into worship with all these black walls. It's so dark. They have a preference. They'd rather have them brown. Paint them white, Pastor. Paint them white. Everybody has a color preference. But let me tell you something. You can't please every single person. And if you can't worship because of your own preference, then you have a bigger problem. Your faith will never be activated if you can only worship under your conditions. And there are so many people that are struggling day after day. They're believers, they pray, they do Bible studies, they go to church every week, but because they can't lay down their pride, and because they can't lay down their selfish preferences, their faith has not been activated. Some of y'all looking at me like, whoa. I thought everybody could just claim it in Jesus' name and it would just happen. Well, if that were true,
then we all would be standing up right now, repeating after the pastor, we claim a bigger building. We claim this theater unto God. We claim 5,000 people to fill this auditorium. If it was as easy as just naming it and claiming it and saying it,
come on, brother.
Then we'd be doing it. I just call it out right now. You know what, God? I'm claiming a brand new car for everybody in this building right now. Guess what? When you go outside... God said, bro. He calls me bro sometimes. He does. We're close. We're close. God looks at me and says, bro, you need to learn a few more things before I activate that thing. I say, God, bring it. Teach me, God. We've got to activate our faith, and we got to learn what it takes. Some people have a hard time coming to church because they don't like the song selection. Those songs are too contemporary. Where do you get those songs anyway? The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? No? Well, maybe. I don't know. We might rewrite a song or two. I don't know. I might have got it, you know. Hey, we had some talent in that Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But some people can't even worship because they don't like the song selection, or they don't like the tempo. It's like, Pastor, it's got to be like this. If it's not like that, I'm like, what? You know? I don't even know what tempo that was. I've never heard it, never played it.
Just don't do it.
Just don't do it. The bishop has a preference. Okay, come on. I gotta get zoned here. Verse 23. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." And his disciples were amazed and said, and Jesus said to them, "Dear children, it is very hard to enter the kingdom. In fact, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." And again, let me just share with you that I'm not saying that if you're rich, you can't get into the kingdom of God. I'm not even saying it's going to be all that hard for you. Just Jesus is letting this young man know that it's tough. It's tough. In fact, it's easier for a camel to get into the eye of the needle than for a rich man to get in. Now, I know that there are theologians out there, and there's a few differences of opinion. What does that mean? What did Jesus say? Did he really mean stuff a camel into, like, man, that's tough? Is that what he meant? Some would say that the camel was actually misinterpreted to be another word for rope or for cable. So then that would make more sense. It's tough to stick a cable through the eye of the needle. Some would say that the eye of the needle was a little gate at Jerusalem that was specifically made for people to get in security-wise, but the camels would have to get on their knees and kind of, I know, for those of you that really need me to go deep and not shallow, I'm going to tell you, I looked all that up. I understand that there are many different interpretations, but you know what? Personally, just let me have this. I personally think he really meant, you can't get a camel through the needle, can you? That's what I think he meant. I think he was looking at this young man and saying, listen, as hard as it is for a camel to fit through that needle right there, that's how hard it's going to be for you to get into heaven. Why do I think that? Because I think Jesus had a sense of humor. And we've actually caught this reference before about camels.
Yes.
About camels, real live camels. And they're big. So here's the thing. I think he was referencing the big giant camel going through a little tiny eye of a needle because we've seen it before. Matthew chapter 22, verse 24. Maybe you've never read this. Matthew 23, 24. He's talking to some people. He says, blind guides. That's pretty bad when they're guides and they're blind. And he says, blind guides, you strain your water so that you won't accidentally swallow a gnat. But yet, he says, you swallow a camel. That's what he said. And in that text, he didn't mean, my goodness, you're straining your water so you don't swallow a gnat, but yet you're swallowing the small gate at the gate of Jerusalem. He wasn't talking about that. How about when he says, listen, stop worrying about the speck in your neighbor's eye. When you got a honking plank in your own eye. We all want to get spiritual and say, well, the significance of that was, if you break it down into Greek, it actually meant... No, he meant, listen, bro, you got a big old log in your eye. Stop worrying about the little speck in someone else's. Is that okay? Can you just give me that? Okay. I'm going to take it anyway. So Jesus here was emphasizing the impossible. Why did he have to emphasize it? Because what he was saying is, with you, it's impossible. With God, all things are possible. Because you need to activate your faith here. By your own power, we can't get into heaven. We are wholly, 100% dependent on God's grace and on His salvation. We're dependent on that. In and of ourselves, it's impossible. But with God, all things are possible. What's he saying? He's saying, young man, listen, in order for you to activate your faith, you need to include me. If you want to activate your faith, then you begin to include me. Because by yourself, it's impossible. With me, all things are possible. By yourself, you can't do it. But with me, you can. And he says, include me. Yes. John chapter 15, verse 5. Says, yes, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do zippo, nada, nothing, zilch. Apart from me, you can't do anything. But with me, all things are possible. Verse 6, anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered in a pile to be burned. But if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for what?
Anything you want.
What does anything mean? Anything. Does it mean anything except this? He said, you can ask anything. But you know what's cool about this scripture? Is if you remain in him and he remains in you, you ask for the same things he's asking for. When you remain in him and he remains in you, the things you ask for are the very things he's asking for. And when you come together and activate, your faith is going to make it happen. With God, all things are possible. He's the source of our salvation and he produces the evidence of our faith. You hear me? He is the source of our salvation, and that produces the evidence of our faith, Hebrews 11:1, right? For faith is a substance, which is stuff you can touch. And the evidence, which is bottom line, is a substance of things hoped for, and the evidence of things not yet seen. That is your faith. And with him, it becomes reality. We activate our faith by desiring him. It's clear we must give up our own desires and take up his. For our faith lacks when our flesh rises. In verse 21, go and sell all your possessions, give the money to the poor, and you will have treasures in heaven. Then what? Come follow me. We need to desire him more than we desire our stuff. We need to desire him more than we desire our preferences. Listen, tomorrow, this whole place changes. We're going to have two rows instead of one, or two aisles instead of one. This whole stage can be moved back. The walls can be moved back. Some of y'all are going to walk in when you see some of the change and be like, oh man, who picked that? You know, and who picked that color? And what's going on? When did that? I didn't. Was there a meeting? No, there was no meeting. There was no meeting. And you know what? If you come in and you can relate to that, when you walk in, you just check yourself and say, okay, God, blessed be more of you. I'm laying down my own preferences. Help me to worship with this ungodly-looking stage. You just put yourself aside and you let God do what he wants in you, and I'm telling you, it will activate a faith you've never known was inside of you. You will call it out as if it were, and God will make it happen. You will call down fire from heaven, and God will bring the cleansing. I'm telling you, if you will let go of your stuff and take up what is his, things will change in your life forever. And I'm about done. Finally, we activate our faith by becoming like a little child. And I didn't read this portion of our text earlier, but now I want to take you back, all the way back to our original text in Mark chapter 10. And now we're going to go back a couple more verses, starting in 15. And he says, I tell you the truth. Anyone who doesn't receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it. And then he took his children in his arms and placed his hands on their heads and blessed them. You see, here's what's interesting about children. Children aren't distracted by their own preferences. Children aren't distracted by material things. Children aren't distracted by really anything. They simply enjoy mom and dad. I was actually pretty impressed because my daughter, my youngest daughter, just happened to park her bicycle in a very bad place. And yesterday, on my way out, I backed up my big excursion. Randy was in the car with me, and we heard a little something something and felt a little bump. I didn't really think anything of it. We barely felt it. But Randy, enough curiosity, said, bro, what was that? I put it in parking. I don't know. I was just going to drive off. He gets out of the truck, goes around the back, looks behind our truck. Sure enough, he goes, oh, snap. I'm like, did I run over a kid? What? He picks up a bike with one hand. He goes, dude. The tire is like a pretzel, just mangled. The handlebar was literally bent in like a 180, just, and it was destroyed completely. I'm like, oh man, just put it up there. He puts it on the yard, in the lawn, and later that night, my daughter had no clue yet. I knew I had to tell her eventually, and I thought she's gonna come unglued. She goes, Dad, I gotta give you a bike. I showed her, and I go, honey, I got some bad news. What? I go, Kennedy, take a look at your bike. I had put it in the living room. She looks at it and goes, what? I go, no, look at it. What? I go, honey, your bike. What? I go, baby, why don't you go ahead and try to sit on it? When she went to go grab it, that's when it all dawned on her. Wait a second. My handlebar doesn't go like that. And my wheel, what is up with that? And my wife, being the great wife that she is, she came to my rescue and said, well, honey, do you remember what we told you about being behind vehicles and love? And I go, yeah, where'd you park that thing? Behind the truck. She got this grin on her face, like, oops. But you know what? It wasn't about her bike. It's not always about things for children. It's just that, you know what? I think she was smiling because mom and dad didn't lift her up by one arm and start laying a belt on her behind. She just wanted mom and dad, the comfort of mom and dad. If we come to the Lord like little children, knowing that God, bike, who cares? We don't have those preferences. When we come as little children, we don't care what color the stage is. We don't care what color the blinds are. We don't care what kind of seats. We just want to be with Jesus. And when we just want to be with the Lord, he activates a faith, that of like a little child. That's what's really cool. And I'm not saying children don't have preferences, because I remember my oldest son, well, my only son, but my oldest kid. He's 16 now, but I remember when he was 3. And my son, you think he's bad about his clothes now? This is nothing new. At 3 years old, we had him get dressed. Like, son, why don't we put some clothes on? We were at his aunt and uncle's house, you know, my sister's house, and we're getting ready for the day, and I pull out some clothes for him. He's like, well, Dad, I prefer this color. I'm like, you're three. Dad, I really prefer this one. So maybe you do have preferences as a kid, I don't know. But when we come to the Lord and we put our preferences aside, guess what? He will activate our faith. As children, God wants to take us into his arms. He wants to place his hands on our heads and bless us. We activate our faith. Next weekend, starting Friday night, we're going to be talking. That's the theme of our conference, activating our faith. And I know that Pastor Marlana, he's already told me, he's got something crazy coming at us on Friday night to get us started. And Scotty Houlet, Pastor Scotty, this is like his life message. He preaches on faith, activating our faith. You don't want to miss that. We want to activate our faith. Can we do that today? Can we activate our faith and let God bless us? I want that. How many of you want that? Don't you want God to move on your behalf? Let's activate that. We want to do that. Sherry, if you'll come to the piano, I want to close this morning in prayer. And I just want us to release God to do whatever it is he desires in our hearts and our lives in this week. Randy, if you'll come up too, I just want to go over that first song. Play that first song for me. The Life. And church, if you'll stand with me right now, I want to get real with you for just a couple minutes. It won't take long. Listen, church, I want you to think back. Just close your eyes real quick with me. Just close your eyes all over the room. Not because we're hiding anything, I just want you to be able to focus for a second. I want you to think with your eyes closed. I want you to look back in your life when you were a child, when you were a teenager, maybe a young adult. And I want you to think of all the times where you had frustrations, where you had distractions, when you had confronting situations. And I want you to think back of what might have caused that. Was it our own selfish desires? Was it stuff that we wouldn't budge on? Have you ever been called hard-headed? Where you just couldn't move because this is how it was, this is how it is, and this is how it should always be. And God is saying to you today, it won't always be the way you want it. It won't always be the way you knew it. For I am doing a new thing, says the Lord, and that which I am doing you have not yet seen. He says, I want to do a new, fresh work in you. I want to put a new song in your heart. I want to put a new step in your rhythm. I want to put something new in you. I want to give you revelation. I want to give you prophetic word. I want to give you knowledge that you did not know existed inside of you. And when you wonder why you haven't quite seen it like that yet, can you start picturing why that is? Was it because we were stuck on holding on to things that bound us? Are we not being well because we're still holding on to things that make us sick? Are we not being free because we're holding on to the things that are binding us? If that's you tonight, or this morning, if that's you this morning, I want you to be free. I want you to release the Spirit of God. And before we go into that, I want to just ask, because I know we have visitors in the room, I want to ask, if you've never even known God like I'm describing, maybe you've never given your heart to Jesus, maybe you've never had a personal relationship with him, and you're saying, Pastor, listen, I hear what you're saying. I need that relationship. I just need to know him. I want to be connected. If that's you this morning, and you want to be connected to God that we're teaching about this morning, would you just simply raise your hand in the air so I can see it and you can put it back down? Anybody in the room who doesn't know the Lord, who doesn't know Jesus the way you want to? Anybody? I don't want to miss this moment. Amen. If we're all believers in here, let's activate our faith like never before. Maybe you're here sitting here today and you say, you know, I've believed all my life, but I've just never seen the power. I've gone to church all my life, but I've never seen it happen. And you want to see it happen in your life. You want to see the power that God speaks of. You want Him to be your source. If that's you this morning, would you raise your hand in the air so we can pray with you today too? I see your hands. Yes. I see your hand. Yes. Anybody else? Yes. On the side. I see your hand. I see your hand in the front. Yes. Anybody else? Anybody else? Say, I need to activate my faith. Amen. I see your hand. Well, today, let's believe together. Today, let's activate our faith. Can we do that, church? Can we do that? I want to pray, and then we'll get out of here. Let's pray this together. Let's believe it together. Let's ask God to come in and shake us up. Can we do that? I want you as a church to just hear this prayer and make it yours. Let's believe this together. Heavenly Father, we cry out to you right now. God, we know you. We believe in you. We've given our heart to you. We've given our life to you. But God, I need to see your power. God, I need to see your anointing. God, I need to see your spirit move in this place. Father, I need to see the river come through me in Jesus' name. Lord, I want to see my faith activated. Help me to release that which I've been holding on to. God, help me to release my preferences. Help me to release my selfishness. Help me to release those things that are binding me, that I might be free in Jesus' name. God, I need that power in my life. And Father, when I walk a walk that does not reflect you, I pray, God, that you would remind me who you are. God, that we would come together. And Father, that we would be united in Jesus' name. Lord, that we would see the power of our Father on this earth. But we know that which you are doing in heaven, you are releasing here on earth. So now we call it down in Jesus' name. Lord, we just give it to you. Give it to you in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's go out worshiping Him, believing right now like never before.
Takes away. Yeah.
time with something specific, and the message was a blessing to you, but you need us to agree with you over something. If that's you this morning, I want to invite you to come forward as we dismiss here. We want to pray with you. We want to lay our hands on you. We want to believe with you. And if you have something right now, whether it's physical or spiritual or emotional, or you just need some strength, if that's you, can you come down right now so we can pray with you? We want to just bless you. Is there anybody that we can pray for? I know that some of you have approached me earlier, so I want to just agree with you. Anybody who wants to come down? Pastor Randy? Anybody else? It's not going to take a long time. We just want to bless you this morning. Diana? Anybody else? Thank you.
world, God, that you would give him a song, Lord, that would be known worldwide in a way that would touch thousands and thousands and millions upon millions of lives. And God, let it be his testimony. Let it be his testimony of how you've been incredibly awesome for him. In Jesus' name, I pray that his fingers would be anointed to worship you with his strength in a new way, that a new song would come forth from the strength that he gives. In Jesus' name. God, activate your faith. He has something for each and every one of you. Amen? Feeling good?
Yes.
Okay. So my wife has a sign-up sheet over here because during Refuge Conference, we want to feed all of the guests that come our way, the speakers and everything. We need you to help with that. Maybe if you can, you want to just provide